So today we will look at another type of the peripheral systems which are necessary to have built around an accelerator facility. That is facilities for or instrumentation for beam diagnostics. Okay. Basically, once you are accelerating a beam and going to utilize it for some particular physics application, it becomes extremely necessary to maintain the quality of the beam, ensure that you are able to measure various parameters, including current, size of the beam, and what are the distribution of the beam particle energies. Is there a spread or is it fairly monoenergetic? All these parameters become important, both from a practical viewpoint, namely you should know number of particles, etc., and also from a technological viewpoint. That is, if one measures these quantities and tries to monitor them regularly, one can avoid large losses from the beam, one can avoid damage to the accelerator, etc. So beam diagnostic techniques or beam diagnostic tools are extremely important part of modern day accelerator systems. Our look at beam diagnostics is going to go along the following lines, that there will be basic diagnostics, as we mentioned, for simple quantities like beam current, beam position, and the size and shape of the beam. These are all important from the practical viewpoint. That is, to know how many particles you are colliding at a time, because if you cannot monitor that, then you have no idea about what is the cross section which you are measuring. Okay. If you remember our luminosity definition, it contains the beam intensity or the beam current or number of particles in the beam. Then the beam position is important. Otherwise, if you have a certain target located at a particular point, one has to know whether the beam is actually impinging on that or not. Similarly, the size and shape of the beam, that is also important. By shape, you can also mean the transverse cross-sectional shape, which need not always be circular, as well as the longitudinal shape, that is, along the direction of the beam, how is the shape of a particular bunch of particles. And this can all be measured by various methods. We will be looking at some methods for each of these measurements. Then there are some advanced measurement techniques, diagnostic techniques, which will measure some things which we have not yet discussed in this course. So I will be giving a brief review or overview of what exactly that quantity means, particularly beam emittance and the Q value. And we will see how it is measured also. And also beam polarization. This is especially important for either a polarized beam type of collider, for example, RIC, relativistic heavy ion collider in Brookhaven National Laboratory. That is a polarized beam collider, so that you can get extra information about the collision system. Similarly, electron beams quite often can be polarized in a certain direction, so that measurement is also done. These are more advanced and specific diagnostic tools for specific machines, but the basic diagnostics which are mentioned above, beam current, beam position, beam size and shape, these are going to remain relevant at all accelerators. Okay. When we talk about measurement of beam current, one of the most popular methods for measuring beam current is using a device called a Faraday cup. A Faraday cup, the basic idea of a Faraday cup is it is an object where the beam comes and hits. So when the beam particles are deposited on this object, it's conducting in nature, and so it will conduct to ground through a current meter, and the current meter will measure how much is the current in the beam. is the basic concept of a Faraday cup. Of course, a practical Faraday cup actually has to be cup shaped, not just a single block of metal. The reason for this is that whenever a primary beam comes and impinges on any material, there will always be secondary electrons which are emitted. And what this cage or cup does is that it is placed at a negative voltage, and so any electrons which have a tendency to get ejected will get repelled back into that particular body, and so the measured current will be the same as the true current. Otherwise, what would happen is the beam comes and impinges on this block of metal, lot of secondary electrons come out, and if this cup or Faraday cage is not there, then those secondary electrons will just go off into the vacuum of the vacuum chamber, and so the total current you will measure is the incident current plus the number of electrons which got lost from here. Because if this is a beam consisting of positively charged particles, then suppose one ion comes and hits and ejects one electron, then you will measure the charge of that ion as 2 plus instead of 1 plus. So you will get wrong current unless you suppress this particular region so that secondary emission from the surface is stopped. This is a practical actual cutaway view of a Faraday cup. This is the cup part, and this is the entrance aperture, and the aperture is put at a negative voltage so that any secondary electrons will come will get repelled back into the cup. There is also a back plate which is having two water tubes for water cooling. This is because if large beam current is dumped into this cup, it will heat up, and so continuously that heat has to be taken away through a cooling water line which is here. And same way, it is thermally isolated from the external part for the same reason, that the inner cup may get heated up. And as it is written here, this is a suppressor electrode which is having a negative potential so that the secondary electrons do not come out. Another method to avoid secondary electron ejection from the Faraday cup is to make the cup very long, and the end plate is kept tilted so that secondary electron cannot go back down the vacuum tube. Another way is to coat the surface of the Faraday cup. Coat the surface of the Faraday cup with carbon soot material, the kind of lamp black material which forms at the edge of a lamp. This is basically pure carbon in soot form, and that is also having very high secondary electron suppression properties. So basically you need a way to suppress the secondary electrons from being ejected from the surface of the cup. If that is there, then you will measure the true current. Otherwise, you may end up measuring the wrong value of the current. Okay. So basic Faraday cup is a block of metal, beam comes and hits it, and whatever current is deposited passes through an ammeter, and you can read it off directly as the beam current. This is the basic idea of a Faraday cup. For higher energy beams, this approach becomes a little troublesome because the amount of heat generated in the Faraday cup will be keeping on increasing as the beam energy increases. And at one stage, if the beam intensity is extremely high, then it can easily penetrate through the Faraday cup. So at higher energies, a different methodology has to be used for measuring the beam. Or if the beam current is extremely high also, a different methodology has to be used. And one such methodology which is used is something called a beam transformer. The beam transformer is a very simple device. It is basically a ferromagnetic material with a copper wire wound around it, such that the ferromagnetic material is in the shape of a donut shaped configuration. And all of this is mounted outside the vacuum chamber. So when the beam passes through here, a secondary voltage is introduced or induced inside the secondary coil, and that voltage will be proportional to the primary beam current, and this can be used to measure the beam current. दिस स्पेशली वर्क्स फॉर एसी बीम्स, दैट इज पल्स्ड बीम्स, सो दैट यू कैन ऑब्टेन दिस बीम करंट वैल्यू. वन कैन ऑल्सो ट्राई टू यूज दिस फॉर मेजरिंग ए डीसी करंट. फॉर दैट यू डू ए स्लाइट ट्रिक. दिस इज सिमिलर टू द एक्सपेरिमेंट ऑन एलवीडीटी विच यू मस्ट हैव डन इन अर्लियर क्लासेस, दैट यू हैव ए बीम पासिंग थ्रू नॉट वन सच ट्रांसफार्मर बट टू ट्रांसफार्मर्स. एंड वॉट यू डू इज यू योर सेल्फ पास ए करंट इन द ऑपोजिट डायरेक्शन एंड यू एडजस्ट दिस करंट सच दैट द कंपेंसेटिंग करंट प्लस द बीम करंट द टोटल इज जीरो, सो दैट देर इज नो वोल्टेज आउटपुट फ्रॉम द टू कॉइल्स. सो इफ दैट इज अचीव्ड देन बेसिकली द करंट विच यू हैव पास्ड इन द ऑपोजिट डायरेक्शन विल बी द सेम एज द बीम करंट. एंड सो बाई लुकिंग एट हाउ मच करंट यू हैव पास्ड टू नलीफाई द करंट यू विल गेट एन आइडिया ऑफ वॉट वॉज द ओरिजिनल करंट. बेसिकली वेन द कंपेन्सेटिंग करंट इज इक्वल टू द बीम करंट दैट टाइम द डीमोड्यूलेटर स्टॉप्स एंड द पावर सप्लाई इज देन केप्ट कॉन्स्टेंटली एट दैट पर्टिकुलर वैल्यू. So, as the beam current increases or decreases, correspondingly there is a feedback mechanism which increases or decreases the compensating current, so that the total voltage developed across this combination of two inductors is zero. ठीक है. So by a feedback mechanism, one can find out how much is the beam current. And the waveforms which are shown in the lower panel basically indicate how a primary beam pulse is designed, and if this is input into the beam transformer, the secondary pulse which comes is normally slightly distorted because of some recovery times or some decay lifetimes of this inductive arrangement. But basically, if the beam bunch is like a Gaussian distribution, then one gets a reasonable reproduction of that, and that can be used to measure the beam current as well as the beam distribution in the longitude, that is along the direction of the beam, longitudinal direction, that is that along the direction of the beam. So this second method, the beam transformer, is basically a transformer arrangement in which the primary coil is not actually a coil, it is the beam itself, and the secondary coil is an actual coil. And so, larger the beam current, you will get larger voltages developed across the secondary, and that can be used as a measure of the beam current. The basic idea of a beam transformer. One can also use the beam transformer for steady beams by the method indicated in the second diagram, in the diagram on the right. ठीक है. सो वी हैव सीन टू मेथड्स, वन इज फैराडे कप एंड द अदर इज द बीम ट्रांसफार्मर. द बीम ट्रांसफार्मर इज एज मेंशन्ड, इट इज फॉर लार्ज करंट्स और फॉर वेरी वेरी हाईली एनर्जेटिक पार्टिकल्स. इट इज ए नॉन डिस्ट्रक्टिव मेथड इन द सेंस द बीम जस्ट पासिस थ्रू एंड continues along its path. The Faraday cup is a destructive method in the sense the beam is completely deposited in the Faraday cup. So Faraday cup normally has an arrangement to move it into the beam path and retract it out of the beam path, so that whenever the beam current at some intermediate place is to be measured, the Faraday cup is inserted into the beam path, the beam current is measured. If you are satisfied with that value, you can retract the Faraday cup and the remaining beam can then continue along the particular direction in the accelerator. ठीक है. So this was about Faraday cup and beam transformer. Another method which works on the principles very similar to the beam transformer but uses a slightly different mechanism is called the wall current monitor. Wall current monitor is very interesting. Basically, whenever there is a beam passing through the middle of a large vacuum chamber made of metal, if you can see the lower right diagram, the green arrow moving towards the right indicates the beam direction. And you can see several yellow arrows on the wall of the chamber. Basically, you know that whenever a single charge is placed near a conductor, opposite polarity charge is developed on the conductor. This is called the image charge effect on the conductor surface. The total electric field of the charges induced on the surface will nullify the electric field of the original charge particle, so that the electric field inside the conductor remains zero. So electric field inside the conductor is always zero, and that leads to this induction of charge on the surface. So when this charge is moving in this direction, the image charge appears to move in the opposite direction. And so the image charge also moves in this direction, but the image current, therefore, because of the negative polarity, current moves in this direction. Means, suppose the green arrow represents a proton beam, then there will be several electrons induced or negative charges induced on the surface of the pipe. As the proton moves along, the electrons image charge also drags along. But electrons flowing in this direction is same as current flowing in this direction, because the electrons are negatively charged. So you get a large current flowing across the wall whenever a beam is traveling through the pipe. And in the path of this image current, if you place an insulating material in the pipe, then that current is forced to go through this bypass loop, and when it passes through this bypass loop, this the current can be measured at that point. There are other methods to do it. For example, this involves something called a ferrite material ring, and the wall current passing through the wall, when it comes to this region, it can be used to generate a signal which will tell you what is the total beam current. As I said, this works on the same ideology as the beam current transformer, but the actual physical phenomenon and the physical method is different. The ideology is the same in the sense some portion of the periphery of the beam pipe is what is used for measuring the beam current. Only in this case, it is the wall itself which gets used, rather than a ferromagnetic kind of donut shaped coil. So here the wall itself is used for monitoring the current based on the image charge which is flowing through. This is the basic idea of a wall current monitor, as it is called. Okay. The second class of measurements or category of measurements which we are looking for is beam profile or beam position. Okay. Beam profile means what is the shape of the beam in the XY direction, that is perpendicular to the direction of the beam. And beam position means what is its just position in the XY direction, that is perpendicular to the direction of propagation of the beam. So all these are coming under transverse measurements, that is measurements perpendicular to the direction of the beam motion. The diagrams shown in this slide may look very complicated, but actually they are not very complicated. Allow me to just explain what it is. Basically, this bluish patch which you see here and as well as here is actually the beam. So the beam is coming out of the page in the left hand side figure, let us say. Okay. So there is a object kept over here which has two wires attached to it, and although it is not visible in the left diagram, in the right diagram you can see that these two wires are such that they are on opposite sides of this central arm. This central arm in the right figure, which I am pointing right now, is the same as this object in the left figure. I am not sure if this is very easy to understand, but if you spend enough time with this diagram, you will understand. It's easier for me to show by hand, but anyway, you can try to imagine this. The bottom line of this, forget about the complicated arrangement, this keeps rotating, and so this wire keeps passing across this beam. This wire passes across it, then rotates, comes back, again passes across it, rotates, comes back, passes across, etc. So whenever the wire cuts the beam, the beam will knock out some particles from this wire, and a small current is generated, and that current goes through some kind of as you can see over here, this is a real such Faraday cup. It goes through a cable, and then it can go to an amplifier, and the timing of this is very important, because if the beam is slightly on the left, then it takes longer for these particles to go. If the beam is slightly on the right, it takes longer for these particles to go. If the beam is slightly on the left, it takes less time. And so the time taken for the electron signal from this wire to reach the amplifier tells you at which position this particular beam is there. If it is here, it will take longer time. If it is here, it will take shorter time, and so on. Once this has been rotated by around 90 degrees, the wire number 2, the second wire, will turn out to be actually in this direction, that is in the vertical direction. So the second wire will detect vertically what is the position. Is if it is on the lower side, then it will take longer for the current to pass. If it is on the upper side, it will take less time for the current to pass. So based on the timing of the signal received from wire 1 and wire 2, you can know the x and y position of your beam. This is another diagram which is taken at the same time, in the sense that when the beam is intersecting wire number 1, this is wire number 1, this is the beam intersecting it. After some time, wire number 2 will intersect the beam at somewhere here, and when that happens, you will get the y position of the beam. So you can measure both the x and y position of the beam by their time of intersection with these two wires. If you are finding it difficult to imagine this apparatus, just imagine that, I mean, that is a good enough for understanding portion. You have two wires, straight wires, forget about the curvature of these. You use one to cut downwards and one to cut across. And depending on where along the wire the beam hits, the signal will take time to reach the end of the wire, and accordingly you can find out the position. I hope this is clear from the way I have explained, but if not, then please let me know. I'll try to explain again.
Sir, please explain.
Sure. Let me put it in this fashion. Okay. This is the beam pipe. And this is another view of this. Or this is the same beam pipe at another time. This is the beam. It is passing through this particular point. Everyone is with me. These are just two pictures of the same beam pipe. Okay. Why I have drawn two pictures will become very clear. This is okay with everyone?
Yes, yes, sir.
So beam is not at the center, which is fine. Now imagine that I have one wire from here to here. It is some kind of wire which I can move through the beam pipe. Now, like, imagine that that is possible. Okay. So what will happen when I move this wire from here to here? When this wire reaches this point, the beam will hit here. Agreed? Yes. And then it will take certain amount of time for the electrical signal generated at that point to reach up to this point. Agreed?
Yes.
I am going to call the time which it takes as TY. Is this okay?
Yes, sir.
The time taken in the y direction, which is ultimately going to tell me the position in the y direction, because I know that center ke liye ty ka value itna hona chahiye. Agar thoda upar hai to zyada time lagega, thoda niche hai to kam time lagega. Where I am timing it, the signal reaching the bottom electrode. Is this okay with everyone?
Yes, sir.
Now consider another wire which runs in this direction. Again, it can move from out to in part of the chamber, and it is moved steadily in the downward direction. when the beam, when it reaches this point, the beam hits over here. Everyone still with me? Yes.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Again, you can measure the amount of time it takes to reach the end of the wire. I am going to call it as Tx. Is this okay?
Yes, sir.
So by measuring this Tx and Ty, I can find out where in the chamber my beam is, whether it is at the center or somewhere else. And this gives you a unique, means if you do this separate scanning in x and y direction, it gives you a unique position, xy coordinate of the beam within the vacuum chamber. Is this clear to everyone, this part? Means how such a measurement would work?
Yes, sir.
Yes, others?
Yes, sir.
Rest of it is just detail. Some clever guy came up with some very elaborate construction which enables you to have both the beam, both the perpendicular and horizontal wire attached to a single object such that you need only one motor and the whole thing rotates and it gives you both x and y position all the time. So the principle is only this much. The rest is actually engineering. Okay. I know that is not a completely satisfactory answer, but at least you understood the concept. Let us be happy with that. And then how a wire scanner beam profile monitor actually works is slightly more complex. But the purpose of a wire scanning beam profile monitor is there will be one wire in the vertical direction which will cut across the beam. There will be one wire in the horizontal direction which cuts across the beam. And the time it takes for the electrical signal generated on that wire in the two directions will give you the XY position of the beam. I hope the principal part is clear, the one which is drawn in red. If the construction part is not clear, it's absolutely fine with me because we are more interested in the concept rather than the actual object, because you will get ready-made manufacturers for the beam profile monitors. If you are ever working at an actual accelerator, you will just purchase this off the shelf, the beam profile monitor. But once it is giving you beam profile, you should know what it is doing. Okay? Is that okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So don't worry about how this thing is constructed. What it is doing is what is drawn in the red color. Okay? And those are not two eyes which are looking towards the top right corner. It is, you know what it is, we just discussed. Okay. Chalo. So we'll move further from here. Another method to measure the beam position is something called a pickup monitor. The pickup monitor is basically a idea very similar to the wall current monitor or the beam transformer. The upper set of diagrams describe something called the shoebox type wall current monitor. Shoebox type position pickup monitor. Just a moment. Let me get back my laser pointer. These diagrams. And basically what they do is something like this. Beam passes through this configuration. You can see that this box is divided into two halves, triangular halves. One, this is the diagonal across which they are cut. So you have one box here and one box here. Everyone can see this diagram? Top left diagram?
Yes, sir.
So yes, now, sir. Whenever this beam passes through, we know that there will be a image charge induced on the surface. Barabar hai. But if the beam is traveling slightly to the left, right, okay, then it will pass through a small region of the first box and large region of the second box. Instead of if it is passing through the middle, then this is 50-50, equal interval of passage through the first box and second box. But if it is on the right, what will happen? It will pass for a very short time through box number one and for a long time through box number two. Agreed?
Yes.
Matlab ek sandwich le lo aisa wala, malum hai na? अभी सैंडविच के साइड से तुम अगर एक चाकू निकालोगे, काटोगे ऐसा इधर से इधर, सो दैट चाकू विल कट थ्रू सैंडविच हाफ नंबर वन फॉर अ शॉर्ट टाइम एंड सैंडविच हाफ नंबर टू फॉर अ लॉन्ग टाइम. एवरीवन एग्रीज विद दिस ना? सिमिलरली इफ द बीम इज स्लाइटली ऑन द लेफ्ट, इट विल पास फॉर अ लॉन्ग टाइम थ्रू बॉक्स नंबर वन एंड देन अ शॉर्ट टाइम थ्रू बॉक्स नंबर टू. देयरफॉर डिपेंडिंग ऑन वेयर द बीम इज इन द लेफ्ट राइट डायरेक्शन, द अमाउंट ऑफ चार्ज इंड्यूस्ड ऑन द लेफ्ट बॉक्स एंड राइट बॉक्स विल बी डिफरेंट. इफ द बीम इज मोर ऑन द राइट, देन द सेकेंड बॉक्स गेट्स मोर इंड्यूस्ड चार्ज. इफ द बीम इज स्लाइटली ऑन द लेफ्ट, देन द फर्स्ट बॉक्स गेट्स मोर इंड्यूस्ड चार्ज. So if you take the induced charge from this box and induced charge from this box and compare, whichever is more, the beam is more to that direction. If they are equal and the total comes to be zero, then the beam is at the center. And more the beam is shifted towards one side, wo wale box ka voltage signal will be higher. This part is clear to everyone, what we just discussed?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So it is just like a wall current monitor which we discussed earlier, but it is picking up the position only because it is a isolated or insulated from other parts, and just you are monitoring how much charge is induced on each of the parts of this box. This kind of arrangement is called a shoebox type position pickup monitor. The usual configuration is something like this, where this part of the box, the back part of the box, is for X position because it has two parts which are divided along X axis, and the second part is for the Y position. So one beam passes through, signal from this minus signal from this will tell you how much left right is the beam. Similarly, after it passes through here, signal from this minus signal from this will tell you how much up down is the beam. So it gives you, this portion gives you the left right information, this portion gives you the up down information. So you get both left right and up down information from the combined shoebox type back to back position pickup monitors. This is for measuring the X direction, this is for measuring the Y direction. This figure or this photograph is clear to everyone? Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Anyone having some doubt, we can resolve it right now. Bolo. Okay, if not, let us continue. There can be other types of such monitors. This kind of position pickup monitor is called button type, where there are four electrodes at four positions. If the beam is closer to the left, then more charge will be induced on U1 and U3. If it is more to the right, then more charge will be induced on U2 and U4. If it is slightly to the up, then more charge will be induced on U1 and U2, less on U3 and U4. If it is slightly on the down, then more on U3, U4, less on U1, U2. So you can find out how close it is to which one by picking out of the four which one is having the highest induced charge. More closer it is, more will be the induced charge. Okay, so you can from this you can find out the X and Y position. Similarly, you can have a primary winding or a core, and a primary winding is not there, that is nothing but your beam, and four secondaries are there, one in each direction. So depending on beam passing closer to some of them, you will get more voltage induced in the respective coil. So this is like a beam transformer type configuration, but with four secondary coils instead of a single secondary coil. So it can tell you the position. If it is closer to any one of these coils, the voltage induced in that coil will be higher. Okay. Another method is that you allow a beam to pass through a cavity, and depending on whether the induced electric field on the left and right side is more, you can find out whether it is on the left or on the right. So this is based on induced electric field directly on the end electrodes. This is induced charge on the button type pickups, or these are induced voltages on these four secondaries, or there is image charge build up on the two halves of these boxes. All of these are different types of position pickup monitor. That is, each of the active electrodes in this case picks up some signal, and based on the magnitude of the picked up signal, you can try to determine where is the position of the beam. All these things can be carefully calibrated beforehand so that you can know the position when your beam is actually passing through it. Is this okay? This is called a secondary emission monitor, where if it's highly energetic neutrons, then if that guy comes and hits on something, just because of the energy deposition, it will ionize. And you can measure the amount of ionization which is happening at different points. So basically what you do is you allow the beam to pass through a certain region and keep some kind of solid or thin foil over here. And you have several electrodes lined up near this so that you can quickly measure how many secondary particles are coming out at which positions, and that tells you a brief idea about the primary beam. Maybe not an exact idea, but it gives you a broad idea of what is the position of the primary beam. Basically, the beam hits some residual gas or some target which you place in its path, and the secondary emissions from that object are the ones which are recorded on these electrodes. These electrodes are finely divided into several strips, and depending on which strip gathers how much current, you can get a general idea about what is the position along this direction. You can have another such plate for the Y. So, I mean, this can work, for example, for what you are saying about neutron measurements. This is another thing which can work. You have a material in which basically you have a scintillator screen, basically a material on which if you have energetic radiation incident, it will start glowing. And when it does, then you can actually see the spot with a camera. And you know, if beam hits here, it will glow here. If beam is on the this side, it will glow here. The beam is on the lower side, it will glow here, and so on. So where exactly the beam is hitting, you can come to know. That also might work for, that works for all particles. It may also work for neutrons. They are mildly ionizing radiation, so it might work. Is that okay? The secondary emission monitor basically works on secondary emission from the surrounding or the background gas. The scintillator screen basically works on the material coming and hitting a scintillator screen. The ion or the particle coming and hitting the scintillator screen. And the material is such that it glows. Obviously, using a scintillator screen is a destructive method for finding the beam position. Whereas secondary emission monitors beam profile monitors with wire scanners, these are mildly perturbative methods, whereas a pickup type of monitor is a non-destructive method of measuring the beam position. All of these are popular in different accelerators. It's largely a matter of choice. Higher energy accelerators naturally prefer something where the beam doesn't touch anywhere, some things like this. But at lower energy accelerator, you can get various different types of technologies. Okay. I hope this is clear. So this basically tells us about how the beam profile can be monitored, or the beam position can be monitored. Both of these things are covered here. Okay. Any doubts at this point? All right, if not, let us move further. Another important parameter which you would like to monitor is the beam momentum. As we know, momentum filtering is easiest achieved by magnets, because magnets directly, the magnetic force is directly proportional to momentum. Okay. So, or the magnet can be also seen as a momentum selector. So, if you have a large beam and if you either want the beam momentum or the momentum spread of the beam, both of these things can be measured using a simple bending magnet. If you bend it, if you apply a certain magnetic field and your beam bends to a particular point, you can immediately from that calculate what was the original momentum of the beam, because you will be able to back calculate the radius of curvature which it took, and that in turn will give you the momentum of the beam. So beam momentum can be monitored simply by using a bending magnet. No further fancy things involved. Another thing, this is a completely different technique, but very useful one for electron beams. Basically, what you do is, if you have a high energetic electron beam, you can have a simple laser pointing at the beam. When the laser photon collides with the electron beam, the electron energy is so high that what you get is a kind of inverse photon, inverse Compton scattering. In ordinary Compton scattering, you have a photon and a stationary electron, and then the photon gets scattered at lower energy. By inverse Compton, what you mean is the electron already has lot of energy, so a photon of visible light, when it hits, it gets kicked by a very large amount. The electron transfers a large amount of energy to the particle, and basically the laser photon gets scattered back as a gamma ray photon, much higher energy photon. And this can be used to ascertain the extent of polarization of the particular beam. The electron beam polarization can be monitored using this. Also, the electron beam energy to some extent, because you know the monochromatic value of this wavelength, and if your gamma ray counter is highly directional, then that can also work out. Okay. But this particularly gives good information about polarization of the beam. Especially if you have a polarized laser beam to start with, then you can get a clear idea of the extent of polarization of the electron beam. This is another physical parameter or aspect which is quite important to monitor for the especially at synchrotron facilities, but for these accelerators. Okay. All right. Let me come to two of the very, very important measurements, which also long term we are likely to come across these multiple times. Okay. Right. The first such measurement which we are going to talk about is something called the tune or Betatron tune. Right now, for our current understanding, what the tune means is basically that what is the number of oscillations which the beam undergoes around the central, what you say, circular path before it completes one complete circle. So right now here, if you see, this starts as a cosine wave. One complete time period is completed here. Two are completed here. Three, four, five, and a half. So the tune of this particular beam is around roughly five and a half. I am just trying to tell you in simple words what is the meaning of this word tune. It is a measure of number of full cycle oscillations of the beam before it comes back to its original starting coordinate in the beam direction. Okay, perpendicular direction mein wo kuch alag jagah pe pahuncha hai, but perpendicular to the, sorry, along the beam direction, it has reached back to its original position. And it came back at a different point. Okay. I hope this part is clear, what we mean by tune. Total number of full cycle oscillations of the beam when it makes one complete revolution around the circular path. Is that part okay? how we have defined the quantity called tune in this particular discussion. So basically, it is the number of half full cycle oscillations of the beam. Now, other questions you may have in your mind, aisa oscillate hi kyun karta hai? How do you know it will oscillate and what is the circular path? Right now, imagine there is a circular accelerator and this beam is doing this. Why it is doing this, we'll come to it in great amount of detail later on. But the question here is, how do you measure? See, because you cannot monitor the beam at every position along this trajectory. You only have a detector at one or two places along the ring. Using the data from those, how do you measure what the beam is doing in the rest of the path? This is the question. In fact, most Betatron tune measurements actually work with the concept that you are only bothered with the fractional part of the tune. That is, you are not bothered how many full cycles it goes, but only the fractional number of half cycles which are remaining at the end. And how such a measurement goes about is the following, that you have a shoebox type pickup, which we have already discussed, which tells you the left-right position of the beam. And that particular pickup is directly connected to another electrode at somewhere else down the accelerator, which is called a kicker. So that the pickup and the kicker can be synchronized in such a way that you can actually forget this diagram, look at the lower diagram. There is a pulse given to the kicker and continuously the pickup is monitored. So that basically what you try to do is, isko thoda sa perturb karo orbit ko. See what changed over here. Perturb again. See what changed over here. Perturb again. See what changed over here. And when you keep doing these small perturbations and keep trying to monitor what is happening, gradually we'll see a pattern, and that pattern will tell you that by how much that particular quantity is shifting whenever you are giving a small kick, and that in turn will, you will be able to determine the Q value from that. I am not saying that this is a complete explanation, rather it is a very incomplete explanation, but let me kind of qualify this particular explanation. The completeness of the explanation will come when we do our detailed study of transverse dynamics. So at that time, maybe we'll revisit this particular idea. But why it is important is rather more important to know. The tune is directly related to the stability of the beam transport. For example, if the Betatron tune happens to be an integer, means the orbit around the circular path is a closed orbit, means it repeats itself after completion of the cycle, then it turns out that the transport of the beam is extremely unstable and you will soon lose out all the beam particles. So you don't want the tune value to be an integer. Similarly, it turns out that even if it is a half integer, there is still a lot of troubles. So you don't want it to be an integer, you don't want it to be a half integer. And it turns out that even if it is one third of an integer, one fourth, one fifth, if it is any rational multiple, those are also unstable values of Q. However, normally our practical consideration extends only up to n equal to 3 or n equal to 4 at the most. So your beam transport, for it to be stable, your Q value cannot be integer, half integer, one third integer, or one fourth integer. If you satisfy that particular condition, then only the beam transport will be stable. So it becomes very important to keep measuring the Q value and ensure that this does not go beyond a certain limit, because if it does, then it will mean that the beam will become unstable and you will lose out all the particles in the beam. Okay. Once again, I am repeating, this is not a complete description of things, but rather a indicative description that how to measure this particular phase, as one of you was saying, of the beam along the circular accelerator is by perturbing it by small amounts and then making this measurement of the beam position such that you get a correlation between how much you kicked and where did the beam move. This will help you to see what is the value of Q. And once you know that value of Q, you can try to adjust the parameter such that it is not an integer, a half integer, a one third integer, etc., so that the beam transport will remain stable. Another quantity, physical quantity, which it is very important to measure for a beam. One is the Q value. The Q value which we discussed was with regard to the perpendicular direction, that is transverse direction, not along the beam direction but perpendicular to it. Similarly, there is something called a synchrotron tune. Again, this is just a terminology which measures the phase behavior in the direction of the beam. Okay, that measurement also takes place in a similar fashion to what we just discussed, which we are not covered here. The other important parameter for the beam transport is something called the emittance. Okay, now the emittance is basically a measure of the momentum spread and position spread of the beam. Okay, what do you mean by this? Try to look at this diagram, the lower panel on the left. Okay, you can see that what is plotted here is x versus something called x prime. X prime, for the time being, you can imagine it as the velocity of the beam. Okay, x dot, what we normally call. So basically, the figure in the x prime frame will be something like displacement in this direction and velocity in this direction. Velocity means you can relate it with momentum. So it is like a phase space, that is x in one direction and p in the other direction. And you can see that there is a certain volume in phase space which is marked in black color, which is being occupied by the beam. Okay, when the beam travels from one point to another, this particular patch can get distorted in many different ways. Other examples are shown here, where for example, this patch is shown here. This patch, which is the small rectangular patch, suddenly got expanded into a larger one, or this particular rectangular patch got rotated into this one, or these three rectangular patches got distorted into this direction, or they got distorted in a different direction. All of these things are possible in phase space. Okay, but what remains constant is the total volume occupied in phase space always remains constant. This is called Liouville's theorem. Okay, so the emittance is basically a measure of the phase space spread of the particles. It is a quantity which takes into account both the momentum spread and the position spread. Conservation of the emittance, or Liouville's theorem, implies that if you try to focus all the particles into a very narrow region, they will attain a large momentum spread amongst themselves. On the other hand, if you try to bring the momenta all close to each other, they will attain large position spread, because total position and momentum together integrated as an area will be constant. Okay, this is a very important parameter, because there could be some mechanisms within the beam which tend to increase its emittance, and our aim should always be to avoid this. Okay, so it becomes important to measure the emittance from time to time and compare, so that you know that nothing is going wrong. The diagram at the top on the left basically shows you that if there is a beam coming in, a magnet is used to bend it, another magnet is used to again bend it back, and then the beam passes through this particular slit and gets impinged on a detector. Depending on the values of magnetic field of the two magnets, different parts of the beam can be sampled. and different momenta can be selected, and that is how you can map the entire phase space spread of the beam by choosing different positions and different momenta. You can see that if a large number of particles are there with different momenta, when it passes through a magnet, the magnet will separate them according to their momentum, so that you get some particles with higher than some average momentum, some particles with average momentum, some particles lower than average momentum. And depending on how the beam travels through the remaining part of the accelerator, the only rule is that the total volume in phase space remains constant. Apart from that, the shape of this can keep on changing. That is the relative spread of position versus momentum can keep on changing from different positions along the accelerator, but the total emittance is conserved. The emittance measurement becomes important because the smaller the emittance, which means smaller the phase space volume, larger is the luminosity which can be achieved. Because large luminosity means that you need highly mono-energetic particles confined to a very small space, and they will collide with other particles of similar type, and you will be able to then obtain the reaction which occurs by that particular collision. Your chances of detecting feeble cross-section reactions increases when your momentum and position spread are small, so that a large number of particles, all of them collide together. Okay. So emittance considerations are often directly related to what is the end use. Whereas emittance being a conserved quantity right from the ion source where it is produced through the pre-acceleration stages, through the booster stages, till the high energy acceleration, the emittance remains fairly constant. Okay. So it becomes extremely important to monitor this emittance, ensure that it is remaining constant, and ensure that right at source the emittance is quite low, so that later on it does not give you trouble when you are trying to do your final collision or final reaction. Okay. And the methodology for emittance measurements is basically the position spread part can be done by using any of the beam profile methods which are listed above. The momentum spread part can be done by a series of magnets in a variety of ways. Two of them are illustrated here. One is by having two magnets such that one bends and the other unbends in the opposite direction, and you can get a information about the momentum spread. Or a single magnet where the beam is divided by different momenta, and then the profile is detected at another point. Okay. So the idea of emittance measurement is to measure the momentum spread of the beam, correlate this with the physical spread already measured using other beam profile measurement techniques, and then if this measurement is available at various points along the accelerator, it gives you a good idea how efficiently the transport is happening, and hopefully there is no sudden blow up or increase of the emittance anywhere, because the emittance is going to be an extremely important parameter in the final stage of using the accelerator beam for doing some particular experiments. Okay. So again, I am mentioning that emittance is also a topic which we will be coming to in great amount of detail. So at this point, if these things are not clear, don't worry about it. Retain this information about Q value and emittance. And when we come to them in the actual context of beam dynamics, it will become clearer why we need to measure these two quantities, what is their significance, and how to measure it, we have seen over here to some extent. Okay. So Q value and emittance, these are two important parameters which are being measured or which need to be measured for beams. These are somewhat advanced diagnostics. These are not basic diagnostics like beam position and beam current. This brings me more or less to a conclusion of what I wanted to discuss with this particular lecture. This is a summary chart which gives you information about all the methods which we discussed in this particular lecture. It also gives you a summary of all the different types of measurements, beam properties, which can be measured by that particular method. For example, Faraday cup, if you say, it is used for measuring current, and it is a destructive technique. D means destructive, P is perturbative, N is non-destructive. So Faraday cup used for measuring current is a destructive technique. Beam transformer can be used for measuring current as well as size and shape, and also indirectly it can be used sometimes for emittance measurements. Okay, once you know what is emittance, it is basically momentum spread. One can see that the beam transformer can indirectly give you the momentum information about the beam if it is placed strategically after certain other components like lenses, etc. And that can be used for measuring that as well. Tick mark means it can definitely be used for that. Question mark means you can try to use it for it, but that is not the primary purpose. The tick mark and question mark, you can just have a look. And beam transformer is a non-destructive technique. Similarly, scintillator screen, primary purpose to measure the position, size and shape of the beam. It could be perturbative or destructive. There could be a thin film perturbation screen such that the beam passes straight through and there is only a glow seen on the screen. Or it could be a thick screen on which the beam impinges and it becomes permanently lost over there. So you can see that different types of measurement techniques are there, which include non-perturbative or non-destructive, perturbative and destructive techniques, as well as techniques for measuring various parameters, current, position, size, shape, emittance, Q value, momentum measurement, etc. Okay. With this, I would like to conclude. If there are any questions, we can take them now. Thank you.